This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Why don't we go ahead and give God some praise today, because he is worthy of all the glory, the honor, and praise. I'm so thankful today that the Lord woke me up this morning. I'm so thankful today that the Lord put his love in my heart and he put his thoughts in my mind. And I like the way they said it. They said, I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Anybody woke up this morning with your mind stayed on Jesus? And we're so thankful to be here in the sanctuary of Oak Grove Baptist Church. And we welcome you again, Pastor Franklin Watkins. We welcome you to this time of worship. And the Lord is a good God. He's a mighty God. Anybody want to just give God a worship in the house? Because he is worthy. Anybody want to say thank you, Lord, as we come before him and we humble ourselves and we say hallelujah to his name. And we're thankful for this day. As we prepare ourselves for worship, we're reminded of David's Psalms. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continuously be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord. Can I say that one more time? Oh, magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord right where you are, in your house, in your living room, in your family room. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. I sought the Lord. He heard me and he delivered me from all of my fears. We're now ready to praise the Lord. We're calling on the praise team now to come in this pre-recorded praise. Give God some praise in the house.
Lord, you are my strength like no other. God, when I am weak, Lord Jesus, you have held me in your arms. God, thank you for your comfort, Jesus. Lord, we just come right now, Lord Jesus, acknowledging who you are and the strength that you have given us, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Certainly we give honor and glory and praise unto our Lord that know that the blood of Jesus will never, never, never lose its power. It flows from the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. It flows right into your living room. It flows right into your kitchen. It flows wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, and the Spirit of the Lord is with us. And we are thankful today as we come to celebrate the goodness of the Lord, because the Lord is good and He is good all the time. We want to first of all say blessings upon you, and we are prepared now for our prayers. And we know that there are so many things that are going on in our country, things seen and things unseen. There are all kinds of situations happening, again, in this political climate, in this climate of COVID-19, and certainly in this time of restrictions, but it's still good to be in the house of the Lord. And we want to honor the Lord today as we call upon His holy and righteous name. You'll see the list of names that are on our prayer list, but what I'm doing today is just laying my hands on this list. And I believe that when the fervent, effectual prayer of the righteous availeth much, and that the Lord will hear our prayers. Let us go to the throne of grace now. Heavenly Father, here we are, your people. We come today and we humble ourselves before you. We, Lord God, come and prostrate before you. We come today as we recognize that it's more than we see. As we come boldly to the throne of grace, we are thankful that the Heavenly Father is sitting on the throne. Thank you, God, for still being on the throne. And if we look over on the right-hand side, we can see that the heaven, that the, our Son, your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Savior and our great High Priest is on the right-hand side. And as we come today and we humble ourselves and we seek your face and we turn from our wicked ways and we ask, God, that you would forgive us of our sins and heal our land. We come on this Labor Day weekend, God, giving your name all the glory, the honor, and the praise. And as we come today, God, we ask that you would just hear our cry. There have been many, God, have been calling on your name, even on this list that we look at today. There are those who even went to the hospital last night, God. We are asking now in the name of Jesus that you would just hear our cry, God, meet every need that's on this list. We claim and we proclaim and we declare and we decree that our brothers and sisters are healed from the crown of their heads to the sole of their feet. We proclaim, God, that you have bought us out and you have given us deliverance, God. And we just pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would touch every name and every member and every friend that's on this list, Lord. And then, Heavenly Father, we come today and we are asking you in the name of Jesus. We know that there are some people that names are not on this list. God, they are maybe in their houses, God. They're even right here in the sanctuary, God. And we pray, God, that we know that we don't have to give you a long list of names, because you know us even now. You know the number of hairs that are on our heads. And we are praying right now that you would have mercy on us, God, and hold us and lead us and guide us into all righteousness, God. And then, God, we pray again for those who are battling COVID-19 right now in the hospital, God. We're asking that you would heal those who might be even on ventilators today. And we pray, God, your strength be upon those who are working for our patients getting better, for the doctors and the nurses and all of the medical assistants and all of those who come together to bring forth healing, God. But we know that healing only comes from you. So now, God, we come today and we thank you again for your glory, your honor, and praise all belongs to you. We are so thankful, God, that you allowed us to be here and to be among the living in this time. And so now, God, bless us and hold us and lead us and guide us. Bless this worship service, God, let it be what you have called it to be. We are your people, God, when we are called by your name. Thank you, Lord. Have mercy on us all. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Let all the saints of God say amen. Amen, amen. Just a couple of announcements I wanted to make. And it's really not an announcement. It's really just some put some emphasis on voting. Amen. It's time now to stop talking. It's time now to, we gotta put all of our action into one element that we are blessed to have, which is the freedom in this country, is the ability to vote. And dare we not sit back and not vote. If you haven't been registered, if you haven't registered, please register. If you need any assistance, I know we have people at Oak Grove Baptist Church that can help you. Make sure that you're getting everything in line that you may vote. You can vote through the mail. My suggestion is that you do that very early. If you're going to request a ballot, get it in. Make sure there are no problems. Get it on in. I understand you can verify that it has been received. So let's do that. For those who like to do early voting, that's a good thing to do as well. And for those who want to be there on the actual day of the election, that is fine too. But let us go out in strong numbers. Ask your cousins, ask your nieces and nephews, your grandchildren, to make sure they are setting themselves up to make a change and make a difference in this country. Also, let me shout out the need for a census. Census is another thing we haven't really talked much about, but if you have not connected with the Census Bureau, you can do that again. You can do that online today, even there may be still people coming to your house. Make sure you're counted, because that is how we get the number of delegates, and all of these different things are lined up with our census, and getting taxes and all of these types of things, or having services. We need to make sure that we're counted in our census. With that, we are continuing to lift up the name of Jesus. Let us praise the Lord. Let us say hallelujah to the name of the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, Oak Grove family and friends. We're so glad that you've tuned into the Grove of Harrisburg, where our pastor is Reverend Dr. Franklin D. Watkins. If this is your first time watching or listening, we would like to extend a warm welcome to you. Whether you're watching on Facebook Live or listening on the teleconference line, we appreciate you for tuning in. These are the announcements for this week. Men's Bible Study will resume on tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. via teleconference. Please note, the phone number has changed. The new number is 617-793-8499. Intercessory prayer will be held on Tuesday, September 8th at 7 p.m. via teleconference. Our next Christian education class will be this Wednesday, September 9th at 7 p.m. See your Christian education email that was sent on Thursday, September 3rd for the next lesson. Attention all parents of school-age children. A survey was mailed last week in our weekly update for all parents to complete to let us know where you may need assistance with the challenges of remote learning. Please complete and return the survey to the church office by this Wednesday, September 9th. More information will be provided on how your church family can assist you this school year. In our efforts to continue being a blessing in the community, there will be another food pantry giveaway on Saturday, September 12th. Please see the flyer in your weekly newsletter or call the church office for drop-off times. Food will be distributed from 9 to 11 a.m. Our virtual Women's Day service will be on Sunday, September 13th at 10 a.m. Join us as we celebrate our women. Attention parents, if your child is attending college this 2021 school year, whether it's on campus or online, please contact the church office to pick up or have a college student information form emailed to you. Please return this form by September 21st. Thank you. the College Care Ministry. The next Sunday School lesson will be held this Saturday, September 12th at 7 p.m. via teleconference. Sunday School books can be picked up on Saturday from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Oak Grove family and friends, mark your calendar, save the date, and get excited. We are planning a drive-in worship service on Sunday, September 20th at 10 a.m. Worshippers, I know you will be excited to be on the grounds of the Grove, but we are asking that you remain in your vehicles during the service. If you are planning to be in attendance, please call or email the church office and let us know. We are trying to get an idea of how many members will be coming out on that Sunday. As we prepare to eventually return to the sanctuary for worship, please pay attention to the weekly newsletter being sent via email and regular mail so that you will stay informed. We encourage you to share with your family and friends that they can watch us on Facebook Live or call in on the teleconference line. The church office will be closed tomorrow in observance of the Labor Day holiday. This ends the announcements. Please continue to stay safe and have a blessed and productive week.
We would like to give a virtual right hand of fellowship to our members that have joined since March through July. We have Anthony and Angela Radcliffe, Alexis and Aubrey Radcliffe. We have Robert and Yolanda Lewis. Christine Bedward and Valerie Jackson. Again, Anthony and Angela Radcliffe, Alexis and Aubrey Radcliffe, Robert and Yolanda Lewis, Christine Bedward and Valerie Jackson. Again, we welcome you to Oak Grove, and we cannot wait until it's time to see you in person. We praise God for you. Good morning, Oak Grove family and friends. We are so happy to have you join us on the teleconference and on Facebook Live, and the ones that are few that are in the sanctuary. We praise God for you each and every day. I have a couple of thank you cards. A great big thank you to all of you. You are so very nice. Dear Oak Grove family, I would like to thank you for all the prayers during my husband's hospital stay. Our family would like to express our sincere appreciation. I love my church family, and we'd be glad when we can worship together again. Love, Sister Georgia Coleman and family. Thank you for your support. When life's really difficult, it helps to have people like you to lean on. Thank you for making a hard time easier. We appreciate your calls, assistance, time, and support during our time of bereavement. Your prayers are greatly appreciated. Love, Loretta Johnson and family. Amen. We will go to God in prayer for our offering. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we just come this morning praising and glorifying you for the wonderful things that you have done for us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for all that have provided their tithes and offering this week. Heavenly Father, the ones that mailed them in, dropped them off, went online and paid, and in their app paid their tithes and offering. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless them in a mighty way. We also ask you to bless the ones that could not give this week, Heavenly Father. We know you know their hearts. We know you love them and will continue to bless all of us, Heavenly Father. We ask that you give Oak Grove leadership, Heavenly Father, the wisdom and the knowledge to do what is needed for your kingdom here on earth, that we use these tithes and offerings wisely, Heavenly Father. We just pray for this Oak Grove family and friends. We ask that you continue to bless us and keep us, Heavenly Father. We know one day soon that you will allow us to come back into worship service. But Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wisdom and knowledge that you give us to keep all of us safe, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning, Oak Grove family, those that are watching on Facebook, those that may be listening on conference call. I just want to take this opportunity to just say, God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. And I know we're going through difficult times now with this COVID, but the words that I've heard is, be encouraged, because you have a friend that is closer than a brother. You have a friend that will be there when you need something. Just call on his name, whatever the situation may be. It's not too big for God. God can take care of whatever the situation is. So once again, be encouraged, knowing that all you have to do is just call on him. This morning, our scripture will be coming from Matthew, the 7th chapter, verses 21 through 23, the King James Version. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquities. I have read to you Matthew the 7th, verses 21 through 23. May the Lord add the richest blessings to the readers, hearers, and most of all, the doers of his word.
Amen. Good morning, Oak Grove.
Good morning.
It's been so long since I've been in here, I feel like the new kid on the block again. But one thing I can say is, you know, God has blessed us with a way to connect with the church through teleconference. It's like having your own cake. Then they gave us Facebook, and that was like a cake with icing. But to be in the sanctuary with worshipers, that is the cherry on your cake. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with nothing but praises in our hearts and on our lips. We just want to say thank you, Father God, for allowing us to be here one more day.
Yes, Lord.
And Heavenly Father, we come before you just glorifying your holy name, giving you all the honor and all the glory, and saying thank you, Jesus. We can't say thank you enough. You woke us up this morning.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
So Heavenly Father, I say thank you for that. As I always say, any day on this side of the dirt is a good day. But live your life so that if you don't wake up on this side of the dirt, it'll be a glorious day. So, Father, we thank you for that wisdom. But, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you again for protecting us through this pandemic, Father God. Oh, you protected your children, and we know that pretty soon here, Father God, you're going to bless us and allow us to assemble again in your presence, because we know that where two or three are gathered, there you will be also. But by the same token, Father God, those that are in their sick room, on their sick bed, those that are incarcerated, allow them to realize that you love them just the same, and that you will be there to heal them and protect them. And Father God, we ask that you bless our pastor here this morning, Father God, him and his family. Allow him to bring the word to us that you gave to him so that it can flow through him and in our hearts. Bless him, Heavenly Father, and his family, and continue to protect us all, not only from the COVID-19, the other coronaviruses, and any other viruses that are out there, flu virus getting ready to kick in. Help us, Father God. Bless us and protect us, and camp us with your guardian angels. And Heavenly Father, allow us to give you the praise for it. But in the meantime, Father God, we ask that you forgive us of all of our past sins and transgressions, sins of omission and commission. Forgive us, Heavenly Father. The songwriter said, give me a clean heart so that I can serve you. Lord, fix my heart so that I may be used by thee. So touch your children, Heavenly Father, and allow us to show others how good you are and how they can receive the same blessings and feel the same love that you've given to us. And we just want to say thank you, Father God. We adore you. We bless you. And it's in the precious name of Jesus the Christ we pray. And let all God's children say amen.
Lord, for everything that you have done for us, God, for every way that you have made, for every door that you have opened, for every door that you have shut, Lord, because you knew it was for the better of us, God. Thank you for loving us, God, for everything that you have done for us in our past, right now, and for our future, God. You deserve all the glory and all the honor just because of who you are, God. We lift our hands, God, and we shout hallelujah. Lord, thank you, Lord Jesus, for everything that you have done for us, God. And we just want to bless you and honor you today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Certainly we love to worship our Lord, our Savior, and our King, and that's the reason that we're here today as we come looking to the Lord, which is our strength, looking to the Lord, which is our help. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, for with coming my help, and my help cometh from the Lord. Thank God again for all of those who are here today, for the deacons, for the trustees, for the sound team. We are so thankful that the Lord has blessed us to be able to share this word with you today. This word today is coming out of the book of Matthew, the 7th chapter. That's Matthew's chapter 7. We'll continue where Deacon McCallum left off, but that's Matthew chapter 7. In verse number 24, we will be reading today the King James Version of Matthew 7, verse number 24. We're waiting on you right now to get your Bibles, wherever you might be. Get your Bible out, get it off of the electronic device, wherever you may have it. But we are looking today at this sacred scripture of Matthew 7, starting in verse number 24, and I will be reading the King James Version. Here is the reading of Matthew 7 and verse 24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Verse 26 says, and everyone that heard these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sands. Final verse 27, and the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. We're going to speak today from this subject, I stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. I stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. Say that one more time. I stand. Say that with me. I stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. Would you please bow your heads now? Lord, we come today as humble as we know how. God, we're seeking your face. God, we need you. We need a word from the Lord, for we know that there's no other word, God, that will satisfy our souls today. God, now would you please come and habitate with us today, God, through your word. Habitate, Lord God, through this preacher. We pray, Heavenly Father, that your will be done, that you will be glorified, that you will be magnified. God, that you receive all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Bless now the waiting congregation. Let this word fall on good soil, God. And we're going to honor you today, that we are declaring that we stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. Now bless us and hold us and keep us. Sit me down or you may stand up. In Jesus' name we pray, and let all the saints of God say amen. There are many things that we as people have in common in this journey called life. However, during this election season, many of our politicians are only dwelling on our differences. America has become so polarized that the United States has become now, it appears to be more like the divided states. Some politicians are trying to divide us so that they may conquer us. But I want to tell somebody here today, before we even get started, stay woke and vote. Stay woke and vote. Stay woke and vote. Yes, we are different in many ways. We are of different races and ethnicities, and blacks and whites and Latinx and Native Americans, Chinese and African. We are of different faith. We are Christians, and there are Muslims and Hindu and Baptists and Presbyterians and Methodists and Holiness. And yes, we are from different parts of this country, some from the north, some from the south, some from the east, and some from the west. But let's not forget that all of the ways that we are the same. Let's not forget that there are lots of things that we all have in common. Can I tell you what we have in common? We are created by God. Genesis says in 1:26, and God said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let him have dominion over this earth. And created God, and God created man in his own image, and in his image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And so, yes, we are created by God, but we are also living on a common earth. All of us are living on a common earth. In Genesis 2:7, it says, and the Lord God formed man from the dust of the earth, or the ground, and he breathed into his nostril, and he became a living soul. And since we have a common creator and we have a common earth, then it should not matter what your political party might be, whether that be Democrat, Republican, or independent. It should not matter what your socioeconomic status may be, whether that's billionaire, millionaire, I just got a little bit of air. But there is something else that we have in common today. We are all on this journey called life. We're on this journey called life. Life is a journey. And all of us have a starting point and an ending point of this journey called life. The starting point, you know, the starting point is when you were born, and the ending point is when we die. But the real question I want to ask you today, how are you doing on your journey? Are you on track or are you off track? Are you handling things well or are you messing things up? Are you living on purpose and on point, or you don't have a clue what's going on? The real question is, how are you feeling about your journey? Are you feeling good or are you feeling bad? Are you excited about the journey or are you uninspired? The real question is, are you headed in the right direction on this journey called life? Are you headed for success or failure? Are you headed for victory or loss? Are you headed for salvation or destruction? Are you headed for hell, heaven, or hell? Now, many of us have read this movie have seen this movie or read this book called Alice Adventures in Wonderland. Anybody ever remember Alice Adventures in Wonderland? In this chapter 6, the author talks about there is a conversation between Alice and Cheshire Cat. And it says, Alice says, would you please tell me which way I ought to go from here? The cat says, that depends a good deal on where you want to go. Alice said, I don't it doesn't matter. I don't much care where. Then the cat said, it doesn't matter which way you go. In other words, if you don't know where you are going, any road will take you there. Brothers and sisters, let's stop taking the road to anywhere, because God's got somewhere for us to go. Why don't we ask God today to put us on the right journey? Because I want you to know, if you have a question about your journey called life, you're in the right place, in your house, in the sanctuary. If you are listening, you got questions about this journey, you are listening to the right sermon. And guess what? You're listening to the right person. No, not me, but Jesus. Because Jesus is the author and what? The finisher of our faith. And Jesus specializes on getting people back on the right journey. Do you remember the story about the woman who was caught in adultery? Anybody remember that? In John 8, it says, and the scribes and the Pharisees bought the woman and put her right in front of the midst of Jesus. They said that, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. I always wonder whenever I hear that, I say, where was the man? But that's another sermon for another day. And he says, and so the people said, now, we know what the law of Moses said, that we are to stone her, but what do you say, Jesus? And Jesus began to write down on the ground, and he says, he who is without sin, let him first cast the first stone. And as Jesus began to write, the people, the old people from the youngest people, they began to drop their rocks, and they went away. And Jesus said to this woman, woman, where are thou accusers? And she said, no, I don't have anyone who's accusing me. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn you. Go get back on the right journey. And guess what? Sin no more. Well, Jesus specializes in getting people back on the right track. If I can recall your remembrance of Saul when he was on his way to Damascus Road. Anybody remember Acts 9? You ever read Acts 9? It says, and Saul was still breathing threats and murders against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest and asked for a letter that he could go to the synagogue of the Damascus so he could find any people that are in the way, which were the Christians who were believers. He said, because I'm going to arrest them and bring them back to Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, it says, as Saul journeyed to Damascus, suddenly a light shined from heaven and it fell, and he fell on the ground, and he heard a voice say, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you? He said, I am Jesus whom you persecute, and it's hard to kick against the prick. And Paul began to tremble and acknowledge that, Lord, what you have me to do? Well, I want you to know, Jesus got Paul or Saul back on the right journey. And today you ought to go ahead and ask God right now, if I'm on the wrong journey, God, help me to get back on the right journey, because you've got something special for those who are on the right journey. Verse 24, it says, therefore, whosoever heareth these saying of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock. Now, the first question I want you to see in verse number 24, or the first point I want you to see, is the first word. Somebody say, therefore. Whenever you see therefore in a text, you got to ask your question, where is it? Why is it therefore? Well, you have to look back and roll back and see what was the discussion that Jesus had before he talked about verse 24, and you'll find it in verse 21. He says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of the Father which is in heaven. Can I tell somebody right now, you may say, Lord, Lord, but there's no power in Lord, Lord if you don't believe in the one in whom he is referring to. There's no power in saying, Lord, Lord, unless you believe in the person that is referring to. There is no benefit in saying, Lord, Lord, unless you have faith in the person that is referring to. There is no salvation in saying, Lord, Lord, unless you have faith in the person who provides salvation. There is no deliverance to those who just say, Lord, Lord, unless you have faith in the one who can provide deliverance. There is no healing for those who say, Lord, Lord, unless you have faith in the person who provides healing. William Shakespeare says it this way: what is a name? A rose by any other name would smell as sweet. In other words, what he's trying to tell us is that words mean something. If you don't really mean to call on the name of the Lord, don't call his name. Keep his name out of it. But you say, Lord, Lord, don't say it unless you really believe in the power of his name. And there's another important reason that I believe that in verse 24, there is a therefore there. There's another reason. There's a reason why therefore is in verse 24. And you got to look at, because what Jesus is referring to is verse 22. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Have we not cast out devils in thy name? Have we not done wonderful works in thy name? And Jesus will say to them, I know you not. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. But the key word, the key verses right there is verse 22. When many will say to me in that day, somebody say that day. What is that day that he's talking about? Well, that day is very important because that day is going to come for everyone that's breathing and hearing this word today. That day will come for all of us, whether you are black or white or rich or poor. That day is coming, whether you whatever you might be, that day is coming. Hebrews 9:27 says, and it is appointed unto men that day once to die. But after this, guess what? Judgment. And that day is judgment day when we will meet our Lord in face to face. Can I just let somebody know we're living in a time now where people don't believe in heaven or hell. I need you to know, as surely as I'm standing here today, there is going to be a time where we will meet our Maker, and he will be able, what he will do is look at us, and if our names are not written in the book of life and Revelation that it talk about, we will be going to a hot, very, very hot place. The hymn writer, I like the way Isaac Watts says, he said, that awful day will surely come, that appointed hour may haste, when I must stand before my judge, and guess what? Pass the solemn test. But I came to tell somebody that day does not have to be awful. Can I get an amen in the house? It can be an awesome day. It can be in a rejoicing day. It can be a day of deliverance. So when Jesus said that day, what he was referring to is what I'm getting ready to tell you is a matter of life and death. It's a matter of very, very importance. So let's go back down to verse number 24 since I gave you that background. Verse 24 said, therefore, whoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man that built his house upon a rock. That's one option. But there's verse 26, it says, and every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. Jesus wants to talk to us today about two very important choices. You know, there's a choice that we must make, and these choices will determine if your journey will be successful or failure. It will determine if we're going to be in heaven or hell. It's going to determine whether we will be rejoicing or weeping. It will determine whether we'll be praising God or gnashing of teeth. Here's the two options that we have in this journey called life. Option number one, will you be wise, a wise person, or will you be a foolish person? Here's the option number two, will you build your house on a rock, or will you build your house on sand? You know, when I think about the word is pretty simple. All you got to do is hear it and take it in. Now, I want you to know whenever Jesus is talking, that means that you need to sit down and pay attention. Somebody say, sit down and pay attention. And right here, Jesus gives a reason why this choice is so important. See, the reason that these choices are so important is what's found in verse 25 and 27. Y'all still here with me? Because he says to the wise person, and the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon the house, and it fell because it was not upon a rock. At first he says, and the rain, that's what he says for the foolish person. It was not founded. It says, and the rain and descended, the floods came and beat upon the house. So one house stood, amen, The wise person house stood, but guess what? The foolish person house failed. But can I tell you right now, though, both of them, whether you wise person or a foolish person, guess what? The rain descended and the floods came. Can I get an amen? And the winds blew and it beat upon the house. So even those who built their house on the rock, or they built their house on the sand, guess what? The rain came. And the floods came and it beat upon the house. So what I'm trying to say, we are living in a time right now. Can I get an amen in the house? Because we see rain. Rain has descended upon this earth and floods have come and winds are blowing. And now the only question is whether your house is going to stand. There has never been a time in our lives where all people on earth are facing a threat called coronavirus. We're living in a time where we're seeing death, and we're seeing now death. And before I was seeing death of many people I didn't know. Now I'm beginning to hear about people I do know. Can I get somebody to say amen? And we're living in a time of death of family members and death of neighbors and friends and the death of strangers and celebrities. And I want you to know, here's what the sign is: the rain, the flood, and the winds are blowing on our house. We are living in a time where we're seeing more deaths, not just of coronavirus, but other underlying issues that we have, such as cancer. We were saddened to hear about Chadwick Boseman the other day, who died of colorectal cancer at 43 years old. That tells us all that we might need to start checking our colon, get a colonoscopy in our 30s. Can somebody say amen? And I'm reminded of the great work that Chadwick did in Black Panther. So I came today to tell somebody, Wakanda forever. Amen. But he's trying to tell us, though, that the rain is coming. The floods is coming. And the winds will beat upon our house. So if you are alive today, if in your life, when sickness, when sorrow, when distress, and when loneliness come, guess what? It's rain, flood, and winds that's beating upon your house. When suffering, when disappointment, when disease, when emotional breakdown come, guess what? The rain, the floods, and the winds are beating upon your house. When poverty, when pain, when rejection, when accidents and complaints come upon your house, guess what? The rain, the floods, and the winds are beating on your house. When pressure, when misunderstanding and gossip and doubt comes your way, guess what? It's the rain, the floods, and the winds that are beating upon your house. But I need somebody to know right now, here's what I came to tell you. The winds, the rain, and the floods are going to come. But your outcome don't have to be negative. Can somebody say amen? Go ahead and give God praise right now. The outcome, the wind's going to come. It's going to blow, but my outcome doesn't have to be negative. As a matter of fact, there are two outcomes. It's right here in the text. Somebody say two outcomes. Two outcomes. The first outcome is for the wise person. Because when the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and it beat upon the house did not fall. Because it was founded upon a rock. But the second outcome is for the foolish person, because the rains and the descended and the floods came and the winds blew and it beat upon the house. And guess what? Great was the fall of that house. Can I tell you right now, the wise person's house did not fall because it stood the test of the rains, the flood, and the wind. But the foolish person's house failed the test of the rains, the flood, and the wind. So when I looked at this text, though, there was still something that was kind of, I was wondering, God, what are you trying to say in this text? And what is this unusual thing that's happening? Well, the first thing is that both the wise person and the foolish person heard the word of God. I can go ahead and sit down right now because I think that y'all know where I'm going. The wise person heard the word of God. It says in verse 24, and he said he heard the word of God, and he did it. He doeth it. The wise person went to church, and he heard the word, and he did the word. He heard the word, and he obeyed the word. He heard the word, and he placed the word in his heart. He heard the word, and he lived by the word. Because this wise person heard the word and placed the word in his heart and performed the word and obeyed the word and lived by the word. Guess what? The wise person was building his house on a rock. Oh, somebody ought to go ahead and give God praise right now. So this house is not a house, but this house is your life. Somebody say, this is my life. It's what God has given me. It's my bodily vessel. And this is not the first time that the scripture talk about house being your life, because 2 Corinthians 5:1 says, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle was destroyed, we have a building of God, a home not made by hands. But I came to tell somebody, therefore, this wise man built his house. I'm going to tell you right now, all that you do for Christ is going to last. Somebody go ahead and give God praise right now. All of the praying, all of the word you're getting, all of that which you're getting, because you're building your life on a rock. You're building your heart on a rock. You're building your mind on a rock. And you can be wise today if you hear what the Lord is saying. You ought to begin to build your life on a rock. Build your heart on a rock. Build your thinking on a rock. Then your life will be established. And I need somebody to know that you ought to stand firm right now, because your life and your house is established. Not based on your word, not based on your color, your skin. No, your house is based on, the reason that it is going to be unshaken is because it is sitting on a rock. Now, y'all know I'm a Baptist preacher. And whenever you start talking about the rock, I need somebody to understand that what he's trying to tell us is that the word is so important for us, because that is what we have to build our house on. But when we line up and build our house on the word, that covers us in the promises of God. The reason I can get excited is because he said, now it shall be if you diligently obey the Lord God and be careful in observing all of his commandments. He said, the Lord God will set you high above all nations of the earth, and these blessings will come upon you and they will overtake you. And can I tell somebody, the reason that you are blessed today, the Lord says, if you are believing in my word, he says, blessed shall you be in the city, in the field. Blessed shall you be if you're sick or you're well. Blessed shall you be if COVID-19 comes. Blessed you shall be no matter how many people fall. I came to tell somebody that I'm standing on a rock. Amen. I'm standing on a rock. And somebody say, well, why is that rock so important? Well, that rock is so important because it is not just the word. And thank God that's enough. But God didn't leave us there. But he said, I'm going to tell you that it is the word, but it is also the person of the word. Can I get somebody to say amen? In other words, let me take you back to John 1:1. In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was God. And it says, and the same was in the beginning with God. Amen. And all things were made by him, and without him there was nothing made. In him was life, and life was a light of men. And it says in verse 14, and the word became flesh. Can I tell somebody right now, I'm glad to know that Jesus is the word and the rock. Can I get somebody? He is the rock and the word. And I need to go ahead and let somebody know, in the Baptist tradition, my hope is built on nothing less. Can somebody? I need somebody to know, I ain't worried about all the stuff that's going on, because my hope is not built on less. My hope is built on Jesus the Christ. He said my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but what? Wholly lean on Jesus' hand. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. Oh! Somebody say all. All of the ground is sinking sand. But in my studying, I still had a question. I had a question about this text. And I'm glad to know there are some inquisitive minds, any inquisitive minds out there that like to stretch the text a little bit more. But here's the thing I really begin to think about. Not only did the wise man hear the word, but the foolish man heard the word. The foolish man heard the word, but he did not correct his actions by the word. He did not do the word. He did not obey the word. He did not place the word in his heart. He did not live by the word. And it's kind of unusual that the foolish man attended the same church as the wise man. The foolish man came to church. The foolish man sat in the pulpit. The foolish man sang some songs of Zion, even came down and people were shouting all over the place. The foolish man served on the usher board. Yes, he did. And he served on the deacon board. Amen. And he served on the trustee board. The foolish man took communion every first Sunday. Because this foolish man was a hearer, but not a doer. Because he was a hearer, but did not let the word come into his heart. Did not let the word fall on solid ground. Because then his house fell. And the text says it was a big fall. Now I got to ask this question. Why didn't this foolish man change his life based on the word? He was sitting right there with some wise people on the same pew. He was sitting right there in the choir with the same, some wise people. What was the difference in this foolish man that made these foolish decisions? Well, this foolish man valued what his friend said more than what God said. The foolish person valued what his boo said more than what God said. This foolish person valued what the hip-hop culture is saying more than what God is saying. The foolish person was always concerned about but being politically correct. Amen. This foolish person valued the riches of this world more than the value of God. He valued the entertainment and the sports and all of the things that this world has to offer more than God. This man, this foolish one, he valued the pleasures of this world more than he did the valuing God. So this foolish man built his house on sinking sand. Somebody say, you ought not be that foolish person. Stop building your house upon your friends, upon your boo, upon the hip-hop culture, upon your job, upon your dope-smoking friends. You ought to stop building your house upon riches and upon entertainment and upon pleasures of this world, because now you ain't got no entertainment. You can't go to a place and enjoy that entertainment. I need somebody to understand that when you build your house on sand, it will fall. And it says, then rain came and the flood came and the winds came and it blew the house and the house failed. So when coronavirus came, it blew against the house and the house failed. Then when the forest fires in California came, it blew on the house and the house failed. Then when the hurricanes down in the Gulf came, it blew on the house and the house failed. When unemployment came your way, it blew on the house and the house fell. When bankruptcy came in your community, when bankruptcy and foreclosure came into your house, the house fell. When sickness came, when disappointment came, and when setbacks came, it came into your house and your house fell. But I came to tell somebody today there's still some good news. I need you to go ahead and thank God right now for the good news. Because I'm speaking to the foolish person right now, it's not too late. Somebody say, it's not too late to build your house on a rock. It's not too late to build your house on the word of God. It's still not too late to build your heart on the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm glad to tell somebody that it's not over until God says it's over. I need somebody to go ahead and praise God, because I feel the fire of the Holy Ghost right now. I came to tell somebody that there's some good news. You see, I know a lot of people are falling in this world. A lot of people are going haywire in this world. A lot of people are sweating in this world. Some people are scared to go anywhere. But I need somebody to understand that if you are a foolish person, and maybe you're trying to figure out what your options are, can I bring another person up to the table? And I believe that he will tell you this: Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall, and Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. And all the king horses and all the king's men could not put Humpty Dumpty together again. But the problem with Humpty Dumpty is that he put too much value in the king's horses. The problem with Humpty Dumpty, he put too much value in the king's men. But I came to tell somebody today that there's somebody that can do something that nobody else can do. There's somebody that can put things back together again. There's somebody that can put your marriage back together again. There's somebody that can give you another place where you can work. There's somebody that can put your health back together again. Somebody say, who is he? Well, he's the Lord of Lords. And guess what? He is the King of Kings, and he is the Prince of Peace. Yes, he is, and he is the wheel in the middle of a wheel. Somebody ought to call on his name right now. His name is Jesus, the precious Lamb of God, and I'm glad to know that he specializes in bringing you back to life. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you remember Lazarus. Anybody remember Lazarus? He said he was dead 3-4 days, but Jesus says, I am the life and the resurrection. I need somebody to say, it's not over until God says that it's over. I need somebody to go and say, praise the Lord, because I declare I'm standing on the rock of my salvation. I'm standing on the rock of Jesus Christ. I'm standing on the rock, that rock that will never give away. I'm standing on the rock that give me strength when I'm weak, that build me up when I'm down. I'm standing on the rock. Somebody say, I'm standing on a rock. And so I'm going to keep standing on the rock. When I stand on the rock, and I like somebody, maybe what somebody need to do today is go to the rock. The psalmist said, where do I go when there's nobody else to turn to? Who do I talk to when nobody wants to listen? Who do I lean on when there's no foundation stable? I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain, and the mountain stand by me. When on earth, all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need shelter, when I need friend, I go to the rock. If you're hearing this message today and you want to know how, preacher, can I go to the rock is very simple. Because the rock is Jesus Christ. He says all you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, and you're saved. So we're inviting you to come now to receive this Lord. Come now and be a part of this refreshing relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All you have to do is respond to this preacher, send an email, call the church office and say that you are interested in becoming a member. And let me just roll back. Before you become a member, the most important thing is that you become a part of the body of Christ. Because this is bigger than anything else. Your relationship with God is the rock. Certainly you need a rock today, because there's a lot of shifting sands. If you would just bow your heads with me and just pray this prayer, Lord, I'm a sinner. I've fallen short of the glory of God. Lord, I don't know how to get my life back together. But I believe in what that preacher said today. I believe that when I say yes to Jesus Christ, say yes to the fact that I want the Lord Jesus to be my Savior, I know then that I am forgiven and I am saved. Thank you, God, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to let you know it's just that simple, brothers and sisters. If you prayed that prayer, the Lord heard you. All you have to do now is follow up with a phone call, because it's important for you to connect with a body of Christ. And we are here for you, and we want to hear from you. Amen, amen. We are now, as we are preparing for our communion, this is our first Sunday, and we're asking now that we would gather and you would prepare your sacrifices, your bread and your juice, and let us prepare ourselves for communing with the Lord. What I thank God for, not only is he our rock, but he demonstrated rock-like abilities. Because when they pushed on him, Jesus had the power to thrust them back, but he did nothing because of his strength. They put him on a cross, and they slapped him, they beat him, they pierced his side, they did many things to Jesus. He did not retaliate because he realized that he was doing something that you and I both need today, and that is to be our sacrificial lamb. And so as you come and you are in your house at this sacred time, let us think about the goodness of Jesus, how he loved us so much. Let's think about the Heavenly Father who sent his son, Jesus. Let's think about the fact that we are now a part of a community of faith, of believers. So what that means is that we don't have to do anything, or we don't ever have to stand on our own or stand by ourselves. We are never, ever left alone. God gives us brothers and sisters who are standing with us. And so let us remember, as the scripture says, let's remember and do these things which Jesus has commanded us to do, is remembering his great work. And I'm going to ask Deacon Brooks, Deacon Brooks, come over and just have a word of prayer as we open up our communion. And once we pray, we're going to go ahead and commence with our communion. Deacon Brooks is coming on the screen.
Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you one more time today, first and foremost, thanking you for that wonderful word that you sent to us.
Have mercy, God.
So, Heavenly Father, as we stand on that rock, we're going to do it by being obedient to you and by listening to what you instructed us to do in this form of communion, Father God. We ask that you bless us and cleanse our hearts and our minds. And that if we have an ought against a brother, Heavenly Father, let us ask for that forgiveness right now. Or give the forgiveness, as the case may be. And Father God, we ask that you bless these sacraments, Father God. Bless them. And let them work in us the way your word works into us. And we want to thank you for it and praise you for it. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Deacon Brooks. The words of the Lord says in Matthew 26, he says, as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. Let us take the bread right now in accordance to the word of God. And then Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this. Let us drink our juice in representation of the blood of Jesus Christ. For this is my blood of the new covenant, of the new testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of the fruit of the vine until I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Amen. Let us have a closing word of prayer for communion, and then we'll have our prayer and our benediction. Lord, we thank you for this time that we have to commune with you, to let you know, God, that we are glad that you have called us to be in your family. Now let this communion, God, be strength to us. Let this communion today be encouragement to us. Let it be an assurance, God, that we are standing on the rock of Jesus Christ. Now bless every person who partook in this communion. Bless all of those who have been listening to us today in this service. We honor you and glorify you in Jesus' name. Would everybody please stand? We are now preparing for the closeout of this service, and we again thank God again for all of those who are here. We want to say a happy Labor Day to you and make sure that you're safe in this last holiday before we get into the fall season. But let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your grace and your love and your power and your strength. We thank you, God, for this time that we can come together to hear a word from the Lord. And God, we just want you to know that we are so thankful for your word. For your word is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our pathway. Your word have I hidden my heart, that I may not sin against you. Your word is sharper than any two-edged sword as it cut to and fro. Now, God, let us build our house on your word. And let us build our lives on the rock of Jesus Christ. Now bless every person, bless every house, bless, Lord God, those that are part of the house, bless our families, God. Let your Holy Spirit show up, God, strongly in us, that we can always have peace and assurance. Now, God, we love you and we adore you. Now, may the love of God and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us both now and forever. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Amen, amen, amen. May the blessing of the Lord be with you, and go in peace. Thank you all. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for coming. Thank you. Mm-hmm.